guys coming. It's really important that you all know that we speak out on this issue. I want to give a special thank you to Mike Cooper from the Make It Fit Foundation. He donated quite a bit of money to help this event get pulled off, so I appreciate that. He's also donated food for the Vax team. The Kazee family group has also provided meals for the speakers tonight, so I wanted to thank them as well. And our speakers, of course, definitely want to thank them. OAMF is a grassroots organization. We started about a year ago. There was about 30 of us that got together at a Foundation for Applied Conservative Leadership meeting that Dr. Sherry Tenpenny had set up. She wanted to be here today but couldn't. We wanted to affect the system more than we were. We were just kind of wandering around trying to figure out how can we do something, how can we make a difference. And so we got some guidance at this training on how to impact the system more legislatively. So we are standing for informed consent, your right to choose or refuse any medical procedure, including vaccination. We strongly believe that wherever there is risk, there must be choice. And we support any legislation that upholds that right and oppose any legislation that encroaches upon it. Most of you here probably know that Ohio state law allows for right to reasons of conscience exemption, which is the equivalent of philosophical exemption, religious exemptions, and medical exemptions. But we have a bill that's been introduced that's trying to threaten that. HB 564 is seeking to remove the philosophical exemption for school children in the state of Ohio. This is unethical and unconstitutional for a variety of reasons. One being that in 2011, the Supreme Court ruled that vaccines were unavoidably unsafe. Any unavoidably unsafe product should never be mandated. 4 million children a year are vaccinated, and that is a lot of kids to be mandated to have a procedure that's unavoidably unsafe. The former FDA commissioner, David Kessler, in the 1993 JAMA report, which is a major medical journal, he stated that only about 1% of serious adverse reactions were ever reported. And I think most of you in here know that vaccine reactions are reported even less than that because they are typically denied. So we have no idea what number that would be. Only 5% of the cases that get reported to VAERS, the National Vaccine Adverse Reporting System, are ever made to vaccine report, and only a very small fraction of those cases get compensated. To date, the National Vaccine Injury Compensation Program has paid out $3.4 billion since 1989. So that's 1% of 5% of 1% of injuries that are reported. So it's an astronomical amount of money that would be paid out if the reports actually came in and people were actually compensated. The American Medical Association this year, Section 8.8 of their Medical Code of Ethics, has listed that they support all three vaccine exemptions for physicians. Despite last year, they had a huge press release that said, "We don't believe that children or healthcare workers nationwide should have anything except a medical exemption." So they preached that last year, but this year in their code of ethics, they believe that physicians have a right to all three. So I think that's very interesting. This bill violates the 14th Amendment because the Supreme Court has ruled that parents have a right to parent their children, including medical decisions, without state intervention, unless the state has deemed them unfit. Your doctor cannot deem you unfit for choosing not to vaccinate your child. That is not constitutional. This bill also requires a medical education to claim a religious exemption. So we've got a violation of the First Amendment there by adding a third requirement for religious belief. The Constitution says your religious belief needs to be religious in nature and sincerely held. That is it. You should not be having to sign a form saying what religion you are, or you have a particular religion that does not believe in vaccination, or give me verses that say why you don't want to vaccinate. None of that. You need to just say you have a sincerely held religious belief and attach a copy of the First Amendment to that if you want. Some doctor's offices are currently having people sign this, even though this is not law. So, and we hope it won't be law, because we're going to fight this bill really hard. Also, they are asking parents, in this bill, that they're asking parents to sign a form while they're at this doctor's visit, stating that, basically saying they're endangering their child could possibly die, and they're having you sign their name. So that's another thing that we can't stand for. We shouldn't be having to admit guilt for anything, because vaccination is not a guarantee, and it definitely has risks. So in some cases, parents of injured children may be protecting another child, and it would be irresponsible for them to vaccinate. So why should they have to say that they're endangering their child? That's ludicrous. We need to start as a group standing up to the government and saying, hey, you guys are overstepping. You have no right to my body. We're not going to tolerate this anymore. We cannot sit by quietly because they're going to continue to take the freedoms if we let them. So you need to stand up. You need to demand that your legislators respect the right to your body, that you can be sovereign of your body and the bodies of your children. Meet with your representatives. You'd be surprised what a point you can make with your representative. A couple of weeks ago, just two moms and I went and met with one of the co-sponsors of HB 564. She did not even realize that the philosophical exemption was being pulled off the table. She thought that the bill was about collecting data on unvaccinated children. So once we gave her all the information that we had at the meeting, which she looked over, and she said, oh, I would not support them removing this exemption. I will withdraw my support from this bill when it comes to the floor if they do not keep the exemption in place. So, I mean, look what a difference you can make. Just three moms, just three of us went and did that. So we all need to reach out to our representatives. We need to get active, and we also need to get active in the community. So it's great we're all on Facebook and everybody's, you know, arguing and making their points and pointing and posting their information, and it's great, and that's a great way to educate people. But a lot of times on Facebook, people can write you off. They don't have to see you. They don't have to see your injured child. They have a hard heart to you. So what I would encourage everyone to do is take some time to step away from social media sometimes and go talk to your neighbor. Tell your neighbor your vaccination story. Tell people at your church or whatever in your community. Get out there and soften their hearts with your story so that they will be open to hearing more about what the risks are. They don't want to hear about it because they're just so closed up. So just try to reach them through their heart first, and you might find that you can open their mind. If you would like to get active with OAMF, or you want assistance, or you want to meet with a rep, but you don't feel confident to go and speak with them on your own, we will send a representative from our group to come with you. Just go to www.ohioamf.org and reach out to us there, or we're on Facebook. We're very active on Facebook, so you can message us there. And we would be happy to put you to work in a number of ways. So without any further ado, I want to get going on to the speakers. We're privileged to have Representative Vitale here. He's a parent of a child that was injured by vaccines and also a strong proponent of parental rights and limited government, which I think we all like to hear that.
Didn't cry, didn't move much, His eye movement was bad. Smiles disappeared. Very, very strange. We did not know what was going on. Now, our story may not be as, well, I know it isn't as bad as others. He's 16 and a half years later. He's doing well. However, he's usually sick twice as much as everyone else. He has selective IgA, if any of you know what that is. I know in this world there's probably a lot of people who know what that is as an immune deficiency. And it takes him twice as long to get over everything. But the other four boys who haven't had a needle under their skin are fine. Do I have any conclusive evidence of this? No. But we have a lot of inconclusive evidence that you're pointing to one direction. And so I don't pretend to say that this is a story even close to some of the ones that I've heard from other people. But it does make you think. And again, it comes back to trust. You know, I guess the philosophy we have in our house is, oh, you have a fever? Good. Let it burn. Because that's the way your body is designed to work. Raise the temperature, kill the bug, heal. Which is why we have four home chickenpox right now. To quickly switch gears to government regulation, what was said is absolutely right. Right now in Ohio, things are not bad. We have exemptions in our vaccination laws that basically have taken the teeth out of legislation that has been passed, but they never stop. Mm-hmm. They never stop coming. And there always has to be people willing to stand in the gap. And I know right now, did you guys know there's an election going on? I know no one probably didn't even notice. Kind of going off in the background there. But there's a lot of frustration. I don't care if you're a Democrat, Republican, purple, green, blue. People are upset. And they don't feel like they're represented. They don't feel like they're heard correctly. But I will tell you, when you call, and sometimes it takes a third call, and say, I want to meet with you. I have something to discuss. It does make a difference. When I see people come and meet with their reps, or meet with them in district, or in their office in Columbus, they change. I've seen them change their opinion on things. In many cases, they simply did not know the information that you're bringing them. So it does make a difference. So I still have a lot of hope, honestly, that we the people can have influence over this thing. Now, frankly, it sometimes takes 3, 4, 6, 8, 10 people, and you drag your kids along with you, particularly in an incident issue such as this one. I think that helps tremendously, but it does plant the seed in their heads, and it does make them think, I didn't know that was in that building. Why did you not know? If you're, you know, but it does happen. We're talking about that. Some people co-sponsor a bill, and the bill changes. And all of a sudden, you can call your office and say, why'd you co-sponsor that bill? You said you were against this and against this. That wasn't in there when the bill started. So and believe me, the last person or group I want to defend is the political class. But it's tough. Things do change. I'll leave you with this. It always seemed a little strange to me when people pressured us with five kids to vaccinate them. And I said, well, okay, so I'm not going to get the chicken pox vaccination or pertussis or the DTaP or whatever for my kids. But if you believe so strongly that those things are going to protect your kids and you've gotten your kids those shots, well, what are you worried about? They're protected, right? So my vile, disgusting five kids that don't have those things are going to die of the flesh-eating bacteria. They're not going to hurt your kids because your kids have been like, you know, they've got a medically sealed plastic on them, right? So everything should be good. It just never made any sense to me. I'm like, well, okay, but your kids, you love that stuff or whatever, that's your choice. And I said the word truth twice, and this is really what it's going to come down to is my philosophy isn't the philosophy of the majority of people, at least in the state government, which is parents are the primary deciders of what goes under their kids' skin. That's the bottom line. And why I say trust is because I have trust in you as parents to make that decision. And I believe you will make it. No one cares and loves their child more than their parents. I mean, that's common sense. I mean, we're foster parents in Ohio. We've seen lots of different kids come in and out of our home. It's challenging. The culture is getting very challenging. It's in severe atrophy right now. But at the end of the day, it comes down to trust. And it's one of the things I think you have to ask your elected officials on any issue. Who do you trust? Do you trust me to make the decisions, or do you think these decisions need to be made at the state capitol, or do they need to be made in Washington, D.C.? Because the further those decisions are made from your home, which in my opinion is the best form of government, the worst off we're going to be as a people. So I trust you all to make that decision, and I'm glad you're all here supporting this effort today. Keep in mind, when you call and you come see these folks, it does make a difference. It makes a huge difference. So, thank you.